here on the Boss Man Show here with North Carolina A&T Aggies head coach Sam Washington out of the Big South. Now, coach has a big game coming up and with his old MEAC rival, the Central Eagles over there out of MEAC, his old rival coach. How are things over there in Greensboro, man?
Everything's good. It's a little warm, but beyond that, everything is pretty good.
Good to hear that, coach. Let me ask you this, man. You guys have not played in over almost 2 years, played two big games so far. Just tell me how exciting it was for your guys to get on the field again and play competitive football, not against themselves, finally.
Finally. You know, it was a long time coming, and it was a very long wait, and one that we struggled because of it, honestly. I felt we was a lot rustier than I thought we would have been, you know, going into the first ball game. And we went in the first ball game with missing 13 starters, went into this last ball game missing 7. So, but gradually we're getting everybody back on the field. And we hopefully by the time we get to conference, we'll be a viable football team.
And coach, let's go a little bit deeper than that. How did you all approach that time not being able to play anybody last year? Because I know guys have the juices flowing, they want to compete, and other guys getting a chance to play, they didn't get to play. So how did you all approach that for your young men and your staff to keep them guys sharp and prepare for this year coming up?
Well, it was very difficult, honestly. And we had to do it because we worked in pods. So we never had the full team, you know, to work with. So we had to get a creative, and we did a lot of half line stuff, and we'll work weak side one day, strong side the other, and then on the third day we'll work inside stuff. So we try to just keep them busy and in tune, and for the most part I thought they did a very good job with it.
And I can only imagine how using last year's experience to help those young men become better young men, because I know I'm in my mid-30s. I'm a little older than your guys are. But for me, this last year's made me a better man, a better person. So how did you use that to make your opportunity, give your chance, opportunity to grow as young men and let them know that, hey, this is what life is. Even though it's coming your way, and hey, you got to be ready for whatever life throws at you.
Absolutely. It's called adversity. And it either make you stronger or knock you down. And we as athletes use it as a tool, you know, to make us stronger. And we welcome adversity.
Most definitely, coach. And talk about this, man. I know with being off, would you kind of help your guys get stronger in the weight room, change your diets, focus on recovery more? Because I know a lot of times young men at age, they don't really value what they put in their bodies. So do you have your opportunity to strength staff to help those young men see, hey, the fuel you put in your body will help you play better on Saturdays?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's one of the things that we preach on a regular. And I'm proud to say we have a new strength conditioning coach, and he bought a nutrition package with him. And we do have a training table now. So eating is a huge part of what we do. It's about refueling the body and rest. It's very important to get the proper rest. So those two things that we really have been preaching since returning to campus. Last year, you know, the beauty of it from my perspective, we were the only one on campus. So now we have everybody back on campus. So that's a distraction. You know, it's very difficult for them to walk around and not, you know, socialize with the population. You know, so, but we're going to have to remain disciplined and do it very wisely.
Most definitely, coach. And like you said, man, their recovery process, their nutrition piece, and a lot of times at HBCU level, the schools can't afford it. The fact that you all have that now is so a blessing, because I know young men need that HBCU level to see how it's done the right way at the high major level. HBCUs, in my mind, should not be looked at as beneath those bigger schools, because I'm a graduate at Tennessee State, so I know all about HBCU life. So I respect it. So I'm glad to see you guys have that. And for your young men to have the opportunity to really get taught how to eat right, how to recover and rest, I think it's a very blessing for your young men in their recovery and their careers going forward.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's been a big part of what we've done here recently. As you stated, you know, since we've been here, we never had a training table. So, you know, that in within itself, I think going to be a big help to the program.
And coach, talk about team camaraderie. This summer, you have guys around you all. I mean, last year you couldn't do it on Zoom. Talk about the camaraderie of your team, them growing closer together, and that bond that you all want to have on the football field. Football is the ultimate team sport. And they had that great bond, go through adversity together. Talk about that, having them on campus and some of the bond with each other even more.
Oh, it's so important, you know, that they bond together. And that's one of the things that we really emphasize over the summer. And that's the purpose of getting them here during the summer. And not only that, you're bringing in a new crop as well. So they have to get acclimated to their, you know, this environment and learn some other people along with their colleagues, their players, you know. So it go hand in hand, I tell you. They have to trust each other. And so we have to do some of the things that, you know, creating some, you know, bonding and camaraderie. And so that they can gain trust and understand each other. They all come from different walks of life as well. So they have to understand where this person coming from, what they possibly have dealt with, you know, to get to this point.
And coach, talk about, you kind of mentioned recruiting, come from different backgrounds. You got the Carolinas, Virginia's up there, Georgia down right below you, Florida as well, Tennessee. Talk about being in Greensboro.
For the most part, you know, recruiting was fairly easy for us in a sense. But it was very difficult with the COVID. You know, one of the things that we did not, we're not able to do is bring the kids in and get to know them on a personal level, you know, because of COVID. And that was missed. That was missed dearly. But however, you know, I thought the coaches did a fantastic job. We have a very good freshman class. Matter of fact, four of them played last week against Duke. And we didn't realize it until after the game. We're like, man, we got freshmen out there playing against a Power Five team, but they helped their own and they did well. And so, you know, those are the things that make it worthwhile and make it enjoyable. You know, when you see a young kid, you know, mature at the rate that these guys have done.
And coach, for you going to the Big South, how has that affected recruiting? I know, and I hate to say this, I know that kids look at the MEAC and say, oh, that's the MEAC. Now you're in the Big South. You know, kids look, oh, it's the Big South now. So how has it been recruiting-wise that you moved to the Big South now and playing those schools now?
You know, honestly, I haven't heard, I haven't felt any difference. And that's the real. You know, I thought it possibly would be an issue, you know, with some kids, but we're still able to recruit those same kids that we, you know, we saw it after. Here at A&T is very challenging academically, you know, so that's the first thing. You got to find some kids that can handle, you know, the academic side of it and the challenges, because kids here compete in the classroom. And so, but I was proud. The freshman class came in with a 3.2 GPA average.
Wonderful. Hey, that is what it's all about, because as you and I both know, at some point them cleats have to be hung up. So you have to be successful in your major, have a good major that sustain you for the rest of your life. Because I majored in business and I got a radio show out of majoring in business at Tennessee State. So I didn't think I'd be in communications, but I am. So having that business degree helped give me that base to do what I do now. So if I'm a test one to any young men out there, hey, go to school, handle your business. You'll come in handy down the road after them cleats get hung up for sure.
You're absolutely correct. I think we, you know, we emphasize you need to compete in the classroom as well, because that job offer is going to be those same kids that you sitting next to applying for that same job you want. So you need to start competing just like you do on the field. Just like you're trying to win a football game, you got to win in the classroom.
Well, definitely. And coach, I'm asking about yourself personally, coach. At what point in your career did you decide you want to become a head coach and help lead young men and make an impact on their lives?
I tell you what, I was thinking it sooner than the opportunity presented itself. But you know what? I have absolutely no regrets. You know, I was a defensive coordinator for many, many, many years before I became a head coach. And I really love that side of it, too. It's dealing with the X's and O's and student athletes on a personal level, where you see them every day, you know, in the meetings, you know, constantly. And so you develop a real close bond, you know, as a position coach, you know, whereas the head coach is more of a overseeing duty, a responsibility, and making sure that everybody is on the same page. And so you don't get as much, you know, one-on-one with the kids. Now that I do miss.
I hear that. And you know what? And, you know, having a dad as a coach, I didn't want to go into the profession. I just know that my children ain't good enough for that, coach. You know, I start cursing kids out. It's not good. So I told my dad it wasn't my path. But, you know, I respect what you all do, because having over 100 kids look after as your own children, like somebody's young men, you are their father. You know, they don't have that at home. So talk about that, being a coach at an HBCU school, having a lot of young black men trapped and raised and become better men and husbands in society once they leave your program.
I think it's a gift. It's a gift God gave to me, you know, to have that opportunity to be able to give and direct and mentor a young man and guide them in the right way and showing them, you know, it can be done. Because a lot of the kids that we, you know, have not sure about their future and don't have no idea what they want to do when they leave college, you know, or when they earn a degree. And then there's some that's not going, you know, that didn't earn a degree, that still can produce and be viable to society. And so I honestly believe it's a gift. The Lord allowed me. He allows me to do that.
Most definitely. And coach, I feel like going to HBCU schools, man, is just such a blessing for a young man, because you feel at home, because the people there understand you and your background, where you come from. I know I came from a situation where I had the most very marginalized community here in Atlanta, you know, but I overcame that and look where I am today. So going to Tennessee State, I felt that love and affection for me, the people around campus, to help me, foster me to become a better man. And I think a lot of young black men should choose HBCU schools, whether it be Tennessee State, ANC, wherever, because they're going to place where people understand them and really love them for who they are and are going to help them become better in this world we're in today.
Absolutely. You know, and I think when I recognize that the most is on Father's Day. On Father's Day, the number of calls and texts I receive, it's amazing. You know, guys just saying, coach, thank you. And they be thanking me for little small things that I may have said or may have done that I had totally forgotten about. And but it was impactful to them and maybe just what they needed at that moment. Again, it's a blessing that I sit in this seat and able to guide young African black males, you know, to victory. On, in, and outside the classroom and the football field.
That's what I'm for, coach, is, man. When you come to Atlanta, coach, to the recruiter for an event to visit, what's your favorite spot to eat here in town, man?
Gladys, I love going over there. That's one of my favorite, and it's a seafood joint. I don't know what's the name of it.
Papa Do's?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Papa Do's, yes.
I don't know the name, but I know where two locations are. I can get to two of those.
Yes, sir. Yes, hey, coach. Well, I will tell you, there are some more for you. Rays on the River. That's Creole food. Six feet under. The name is terrible, but it's two locations in Grant Park and 11th Avenue, 6 feet under, and Rays on the River. You will enjoy that. And the juicy crab as well, coach. So that's your seafood. Those three spots for you.
All right, Bob. I certainly will remember that.
Yes. Yes, sir. Coach Wash, thank you for your time tonight, coach.
Absolutely.
We'll do this again real soon. Best luck to get Central, and hope you great year and be healthy and be safe. I'll talk to you real soon, coach.
Thank you so very much. Enjoy.
Have a great night now.
You as well.
All right.